Hi, my name is Dennis Allen, and I'm here in my hometown of Inuvik, Northwest Territories. Inuvik is hosting the National Northern Event on the Truth and Reconciliation Commission on Indian Residential Schools.
This week's events are taking place in the shadows of Sir Alexander Mackenzie School, where, over the years, hundreds of children from Inuvik and other communities were forced to attend. Today, young and old are gathering here, reuniting with old friends and former classmates. People have journeyed from far and wide, coming from many different communities, faiths, and traditions to participate in this special event.
We are honored to welcome the residential school survivors, their families, and visitors from across Canada to Inuvik to participate in the second National Truth and Reconciliation event.
The reality is that this event is not simply about trying to cry about what we've got, but to realize that we have such an important opportunity for us to take ourselves away from our history and to make things better for our children and our family. You know, we've suffered a lot, and I don't think that we need to do that any longer.
All the ups and downs we've been through, and will be many more in front of us. But thank God for our elders who persevered, and I want to say to all of you who've had difficulty, take strength out of that difficulty, because our ancestors did, our grandparents did, otherwise we wouldn't be here today.
We all have our lives and we wander on, but we have these experiences and we all would think it's ourselves, just us that's having those feelings. And I really believe it's a great opportunity for people to find out how each of them have survived beyond, you know, the problems and tribulations that they've had from the hostile days. You know, it's another step.
One of the reasons the TRC is holding a national event here in Inuvik is because Canada's North has the highest ratio of residential school students per capita. And even though Inuvik is a small town, the spirit and desire of the people here to host the TRC is enormous.
I mean, people are excited to have this event here. I tell people people are happily inconvenienced. I mean, people know it's a lot of people in our community, but it's exciting. And even people that aren't survivors, that weren't involved, still want to come out and take part and see what it's all about. So it's been great.
We want to be able to support you. And as our offer, our gesture of reconciliation, we offer our beautiful community to you. And it is our hope that providing our wonderful community as the backdrop for this event, that you will realize what a truly amazing place Inuvik has become.
We know that there has always been a forward-looking view that this community has taken to its life. And that kind of a message is important for us to be able to send to all of the other communities of survivors that exist throughout this country.
I hope that over your time of visiting and sharing, that yes, there will be times of tears, but I hope those tears will be tears of joy as we begin the healing process and wrapping it up and going forward from here, back to our communities to help share the story of rebuilding, of going forward, remembering who we are and what we stand for, like our elders did.
I think it's a really important process in regards to the healing and the reconciliation and the acknowledgement of the pains and the hurts. And it's an individual journey. However, you're not alone. We're not alone. We have many people here that are here to support one another, and we're all together in on this.
You just get to see all of these people again and remember the good times. And, you know, and that to me, I always think was one of the best gifts of all, is that bringing all the people here to Inuvik, and we got to meet all of them and know them personally and have lifelong relationships with them.
I pray we have a week filled with creativity, spirituality, and prayer so that healing does happen and that we all allow forgiveness to be our guide.
I'd like to extend a welcome to all of the children of survivors and all of the grandchildren of survivors who are here as well. And the one thing that we would like you, who are the children of survivors, to talk about with them is that they need not worry about the future, that you are prepared to take up the challenge of ensuring that the future for this country, and in particular for Aboriginal children in this country, is going to be a good future. The survivors who are here need to hear that, need to know that it has not been for nothing that they have survived.
So as you partake in this truth and reconciliation process over the next few days, I pray that this spirit that we have here in Inuvik surrounds you and you truly find the peace you deserve.
Our first couple are Lewis, couple of the group, Tyron Kazoon and Liana Cardinal. The next smallest boy, Darian Kazook and Florence Nasagalawa.
That was our first day here at the Truth and Reconciliation Commission here in Inuvik. What we want to convey to you is the hope and healing former students are speaking of. We will be bringing you more stories like this throughout the week. Have a good night. My name is Dennis Allen.
Next we have Richard Stewart and Leslie Kazoon.
We are going to begin our circle or our dialogue of resilience. And we are very happy to have the very amazing Sheila Rogers, who was also, if you can remember yesterday, inducted as an honorary witness for the Truth and Reconciliation Commission. And so we're very proud of that. Let's give Sheila a big round of applause for accepting that amazing honor. As soon as we are done with this circle, we will be moving right into the commissioner sharing panel in the same venue. And all of the activities that were to take place outside throughout our day will now take place next door. So just so that you're all aware of that. All right? So I'd like to introduce Sheila, who is also a mental health and literacy advocate. She is a veteran CBC broadcaster and journalist.
Thanks, Mom.
Oh, yeah. An Order of Canada and honorary doctorate recipient. Ladies and gentlemen, please put your hands together for Sheila Rogers.
Thank you. Thank you, everyone. And I must say I'm so delighted to be with you in this forum. I think the dialogue on resilience is going to be very powerful. Not to put any pressure on it, I think it's going to leave us with a great deal of hope as well. I have a couple of things just to say before we begin, and you may have heard Chief Norma Cassie speaking before. She had to leave. She couldn't be part of this circle. It's very important to note that women have achieved as much as men, and I wouldn't say that even if I was just a female, but that for reasons of transportation, prior commitments, she had to get a plane. We had other women who were scheduled to be here. You may notice that we are missing somewhat of a Yukon presence as well. There is a big meeting of the Assembly of First Nations. The Yukon chiefs have had to be there, and so they're not represented in this panel as well. I want you to know we had every intention, and then people just couldn't make it. Jerry Alfred was to be with us as well, but I'm afraid he's ill. He played through his illness last night. He was absolutely amazing. And I do want to begin by honoring you and to say how grateful I am to be at the National Gathering and to be present for and participate in this dialogue on resilience. I also wish to honor and respect the Inuvialuit and the Nitatgwichin and the Métis and thank them for their welcome to their traditional homeland and for the care that they have taken of this land and the great stewardship of its land since time immemorial. Your stewardship is inspiring to all Canadians. I'm not going to tell you who I am in terms of what I do. If I've learned one important thing from being in the company of Aboriginal people, they don't go around saying, I'm this and I'm that and I achieved this. So it's a tough panel because I'm asking people to talk about their achievements. But I want you to know who I am in terms of how I define myself and my roots. I'm 55 years old. I live on Gabriola Island. You're all welcome to come and visit in the middle of winter. We have a really nice cabin. And I'm serious, it would be lovely to see you. And I'm from a family of four kids. When I was 15, my parents divorced. This was an incredibly traumatic time for me and the beginning, I think, of a lifelong relationship with depression. 2 years after that, I was in a car accident, and I think the concussion I suffered from going through a windshield just made depression a great constant in my life. And I think one of the reasons I was very interested in hosting this panel is that I've had to get past this depression. I don't want it to be something that defines me. I'm a person living with depression, but it's not my whole life, that's for sure. And I'm very, very inspired by the resilience in the whole room. You're all resilient, every single one of you, every survivor, the families of survivors. I want you to know that that's the foundation that this discussion starts on. I needed to find a definition of resilience. The first time I ever heard the word was in an ad for Johnson's Paste Wax back in the 1960s. This would be something that you'd pour on the floor, and it would make your floor resilient to bumps and scrapes and damage. So you can see there's a human application. I looked it up in a dental dictionary. An act of springing back. Capability of a strained body to recover its size and shape after deformation. And I am seeing more human applications. But really what it is the second definition in the Oxford English Dictionary, which is the capacity to recover from difficulties, a toughness. I understand this in a personal way. I will tell you just one more thing about my family. I come from a long line of self-medicators with alcohol and also people dealing with depression. And my brother, who lived on the downtown East Side for years, was a heroin addict. He gave it up. He went cold turkey. Then he became an alcoholic, because it was in his genes. I swear it was the family gift. And he's been sober for 4 years. And I would say this is a resilient young man. And if he can do it, we can do it. I want to begin our discussion, as my husband would say, enough about you. I'm going to turn to my right. I'm going to turn to my left. I'm going to square dance. That's what I'm going to do. I'm very happy that Richard Narasu could join us. First of all, you are an amazing dancer. Absolutely. And I've just, because I thought we were going to the right, forgive me, I'm learning. I've lost your biography, so I'm going to ask you to tell me about yourself, where you're from, first of all. And I think we need a microphone for Richard. Yeah. And here, in the meantime.
Yeah, my name is Richard Narasu, and I was just so you know who I am. And I'll talk a little more about the issues later on, but I was actually born in the Peel River, out toward Fort McPherson. I'll talk a little bit about the circumstances. I'll talk a little bit about the circumstances later on, because I think it's been a real part of my life, and has been a cause of a lot of animosity in many respects toward me, simply because I was born out of a relationship and out of wedlock. But my mother delivered me by herself with no nurses in a tent on the Peel River and took care of herself. I know that my mother, Tabitha, who adopted me, was there but not actually taking care of other children, so they wouldn't be allowed around the delivery and the experience of that. So I've been involved. I went to school in Fort McPherson at Fleming Hall. I came to Stringer Hall, and I'll explain how I got to Yukon Hall later on, because I think that's part of what you might say is that whole issue of resilience and making decisions and judgments and sharing experiences. Before I go any longer, though, I just wanted to say this. You know, one of the things that even Les and I were talking about just a few minutes ago, you know, through all the challenges that we've had and the experiences that we've had in residential school, it's an amazing that the decision about this panel is in this room. You know, this school was divided. This morning I was listening to you. This school was actually divided into two religions. On that side was the Roman Catholics. On this side was the Protestants. In this gym, when we had the Lions, when we had the people that were like Larry Gordon and Fred Bennett and Cecil Hansen and Rudy Cockney and all of those athletes that were here playing basketball that we all came to, there wasn't an issue at all about the division, about our residences and those that lived here. Because those teams and the athletes that played in this gymnasium got rid of all the differences that we had. When we came here Friday nights or Saturday nights to dance, that issue of the division of the school and the residences wasn't an issue. And do you think about the stage up there, and you could see Larry Gordon playing up there with Louis Goose, called the LGs, and then you added Charlie Furlong, and they became the Delta Nairs. And you know, for me, I think about that, and I'm just talking about that a little bit. And then you saw Lawrence Thrasher that was playing up here as well. And I just want to explain this because for me, this was a place that it didn't matter which residence you were in, what section of the school you were being educated in, or who you were. This place was a place that unified all our students. Because that, I remember Friday nights, all those stands up there were full of the students that were here cheering for our Lions. And it didn't matter. So I just wanted to make that comment to you.
You can keep the microphone. Now we've got two. In those days, could you possibly have imagined that you would go on to become the Speaker of the Legislative Assembly or the Premier of the Northwest Territories?
Well, no. The reality is that we came from a small community with parents that, Peter and Tabitha Nirsu that raised me and adopted me. And then, of course, my grandfather and grandmother, Lucy and Brian Francis, had actually raised me when I was younger at Clondie. And I remember, I didn't remember all of that, but told. But I think I want to say this issue, I think that's really bothered me for a long, long time. But, you know, one of the things that has happened, and I've since talked to my mother Doris, my maternal mother, but the fact that I was born in a relationship that was not right at the time created real animosity between families, even directed toward me. And the sad part in those kinds of situations is that it's not the fault of the child. It's not the fault of the child. You just happen to be born in those circumstances and those conditions, and it's not your fault. But the reality is that through history, even to today, there are still people that hold great grudges against me simply because of those circumstances. And I find it very difficult, you know, lots of times to function, because my job as a leader is never to choose sides among people. Is to represent all those that are part of my people. And I need to say this because unless I get rid of it now, I'll continue to carry it. And I need the public to hear it, because if I don't, then you won't hear the rest of my story. I want to say that, some of the things that people have talked about, even in the experience of getting here, being a member of the assembly, and I see some of my colleagues here, and I acknowledge Mr. Anahuac, and I apologize for not thanking the commissioners and the commission, Truth and Reconciliation Commission, for coming here, and of course, Les and and all of those that are here, right? And Pauline, and Paul, some of us have all served, and Robert. We've all been in situations and circumstances that have never been of our own making. Some of it we've not made it easy for ourselves, but I always remember that, and one thing that we haven't really talked about is that despite where we've gone, is that there's still a history that needs to be talked about. Beyond just the idea of residential schools itself and the administrators and those supervisors that were abusive of the students, or for that matter, in some instances, the educators were those that were teachers. But the reality is that students abused students. Students bullied students. And if we don't get to a point where we address those issues, even to a point of apologize, and I don't even know if we need to apologize to each other, but the reality is that we need to acknowledge it. Because our whole communities have been divided as a result of it. People have said things in school that have carried memories for years. For years. And it's not created. Some good friends have in fact gone away from each other because of simple things we've said to each other. And for me, it's like I can't talk about my experiences and the successes because I don't see it as all success.
But as a leader, when you realize you have to be a leader for all people, where do you find the strength to get past the grudges that you spoke of?
Well, you know, one thing my mother, Tabitha, said to me is that always be good to people, no matter how difficult it is. And that's a real hard thing for people to do. And I always remember having a good conversation with her. And she was the one that actually took me to the student residence in Fort McPherson, dropped me off, and watched me go. And, you know, you think about that, and she told me not too long ago that for years she cried. And for her to say that, knowing the circumstances we were in and the difficult decision she had to make, I think was very courageous of her. And so for me, I think that a great part of the result of where I've been has been her decision and her choice. And I've made other decisions, of course, and I'd like to talk about them. I know I don't want to take lots of the time, but some of the things, for instance, I'll just quickly say this. I went to residential school in the Yukon. And even though I had great friends in Stringer Hall and great support by Mr. Holman, the administrator, I remember thinking, going home one summer, and I thought, I don't want to be part of anything that takes me into drinking and all those things, and that was a hard thing. But the hard part for me was just making the decision to write a letter, I remember, to F.H. Collins, asking if I could get into the school, if they had any room, because to be really honest with you, I didn't know Whitehorse. I didn't know how big F.H. Collins was. Mm-hmm. And I remember working all summer, coming down here, and Mr. Holman said, I don't want you to go to Whitehorse. And I remember going and paying for my ticket, getting on the plane, going to Whitehorse. It was the best decision I made because it was my decision. I remember going to the hotel, Taku, those people that remember Taku. And I spent 1 week in that hotel
and I negotiated my way into Yukon Hall. Not because I thought residences were a good thing, but I needed a place to stay. And the experience was that I ended up making great friends in Yukon Hall. Some of them are leaders in the Yukon. And, you know, all of those things I think about, and I remember going to, you know, I know that a lot of people talk to Mr. Ferguson, Bill Ferguson. And I remember him saying to me, Richard, I think you should go back to Nuvik. It has a great educational system. And I said, no, I don't want to come back. So I spent all my hard-earned money staying in that hotel. And in fact, Randall Charlie at the time, was a person that I became very good friends with. And so I spent most of my money that I had made all summer working for the Power Corporation and negotiated my way into the residence. And that was a hard thing to do. I was a long ways away from home, long ways away from my mother, my parents, my any kind of support system I had. But the one thing that I always remember about L.P. Holman, who was a great support to many, was about every month he sent me $20. And I couldn't believe that because I never asked him for it. Thank you.
Richard, thank you. Richard Nersu, Chief of the Gwich'in Tribal Council. Richard, could you pass the microphone to Les Carpenter? I asked Lawrence Norbert how he would introduce Les Carpenter, and he said, who? You're good friends, right? Are you still good friends? You know him as Mr. Saturday Night, and for a long time hosted the Saturday Night Request show. I know Les because he worked at the CBC. He's now the CEO of CKLB Radio, the voice of the Dene Day. And a big part of the True North concerts as well, Les, right? That happened right here in this gymnasium. I'm just blown away to be here myself. Please welcome Les Carpenter.
First of all, I don't really feel comfortable sitting here. I don't know why I'm here amongst such a prominent and successful collective. I always like to think of myself in simple terms as somebody that was born in Fort McPherson. My hometown is Sax Harbor, but I will always be from Inuvik. I don't yet, in my own mind, consider that I have accomplished what I want to accomplish, which I don't know what it is that I want to accomplish. There's always been something that continues to drive me to do things I want to do, and I've been fortunate in that I've been able to work at most everything that I've wanted to do. I came from very humble beginnings. I guess if you look at it now, it's gone from igloos to internet. Growing up carefree on the land, and then being sent away at 6 years of age, and pretty much just being blown away by the entire experience, where from a small community of, at that time, about 70 people, to be thrust at the doorway of a building that was the largest thing I had ever seen in my life and contained more students there than were in my entire community. But, you know, I think we are all products of our time, products of our communities, our regions, and products of our people. To me, one of the most important things that remains today is from a very young age, probably about 3 years old, I discovered radio. Radio to me was just absolutely magical. Out north of Sax Harbor, where I lived the winters with my mother, to be able to tune in to a hockey game, just fascinated me. And I think from that early age on, I always wanted to do hockey games. But when I went to school, radio still played an extremely large part, because it was something that served as a solace, something that you could look to, because at certain times of the day, CHAK would broadcast announcements and messages. And in those days, there was no picking up the telephone, so occasionally, by way of telegram, CHAK would get messages from our parents to pass along to us over the radio. And I always remember at certain times just staring at that radio, because that was the only connection that I had to my parents and to my community. And it was something that I always hung on to. Although as things evolved, it was sort of in the back of my mind. I don't really have, I think, harsh memories of growing up in Stringer Hall. You know, there are a few instances, but I was no worse off than a lot of the other students who went through that facility. At the same time, if you could make some kind of comparison, it might be akin to the Lord of the Flies, where within a system unto its own, there developed a hierarchical society, and you had to exist, function, and survive within that society itself. And for the most part, we made it through. But in that system as well, we developed for ourselves, out of necessity, a family kind of component. And that was, at that time, our way to survive. And so a lot of those people who I haven't seen for 35 years, a part of that family at that time, I saw some of them over the course of the last couple of days. And it's nice to see that a lot of them have gone on and done really well. But again, too, for some of us who went through that system, and I make no comparisons whatsoever between Grolier Hall and Stringer Hall. They were two separate worlds. And the thing that always stands out in my mind coming to Inuvik at 6 years of age was the very first thing that I learned was that I learned to hate. And I was taught to hate Catholics. Out the back of this school, in that direction, there was a utilidor which divided Stringer Hall and Grolier Hall. And at that young age, there would be, you know, at some times up to 50 students on each side of that utilidor with slingshots, with bows and arrows. And it was something that I found very hard to deal with because my best friend from home, Patrick Kudluck, his family was Catholic, whereas I was Anglican. But in those small communities in those days, because they were so small, a lot of them didn't have any established religion within the community other than what your parents had been subject to. And so if a priest came to town, it didn't matter if you were Catholic or Anglican, everybody went to church. And the same thing if an Anglican minister came to town. I mean, the Catholics came to the church as well. But once you got here within this system, it was a system that taught you that there was a fine line. Although, I mean, to this day, I still don't know what that fine line is between those two religions.
What got you past that hate? What allowed you to move beyond that?
Well, it was difficult because both Patrick and I, when we got home in the summer after not having any kind of relationship through the 10 months, it was hard to come together again and be friends again. But, you know, it's one of those things, too, where depending on your upbringing, you were taught, as Richard said, you know, to always look at the good in everyone and to always
be good to people.
To be nice to everyone because, I mean, eventually, you know, it's going to come back to you. So I think, you know, for the most part, I think everybody found a way to get around it. And the best thing that they ever did in this education system within this community was to do away with that segregation that we had based on, you know, religion. And then things opened up and you know, I mean, immediately you became, you know, friends with those in Grolier Hall and those who were Catholic. And there was no thought of religion anymore. It was everybody helping each other to try and get through the system. And so, you know, based on that, I think I had it much easier, I think, than a lot of the students that went through there. I know for a fact because I've lost some very, very good friends who, you know, suffered in other ways. But, I mean, that's one thing that always sticks with my mind, you know, and... you know, there was a German politician, Rudolf Scharping, who said once that remembrance is the secret to reconciliation. And as long as, for me, just me personally, I don't advocate this for anybody. For me personally, it's remembering those things at certain points when you're confronted with situations or difficulties. Or achievements. With achievements, you pay homage in remembrance to those who weren't able to come along and be beside you. And still, too, I think, to be perfectly honest, is that there is still a small bit of hatred for government within my system, within my psyche. And that, as hard as I may try or as hard as others try, is something that I think that will never go away because it is my remembrance. And that is, as Rudolf Scharping said, that secret to reconciliation. It's complicated within my mind and the way I think it. But at the same time, too, there's something there that tells me not to give complete trust because despite the fact that there was an apology made, anybody can make an apology. But I want to see the results and the benefits that come with that. Because You know, we're all the ones who supposedly, or who are in this process of trying to come to terms with what, you know, we had all gone through. A lot of us worse than others. But at the same time, it should be the government and the Canadian public as well who take it upon themselves to adjust and to deal with what it is that they did to our societies. At the same time, I have a fear that as time goes on, even though within our territories and our regions, we may be the largest private landowners in the world, I fear ghettoization within our own country, within our own lands, as immigration picks up coming into this country, as other issues arise, if there is no resolving of what it is we can do in terms of how we can assist these people that we wronged, then slowly we'll become further and further marginalized, and eventually we'll get to the point where we're of little significance or will be forgotten. At the same time, we will continue within ourselves to grow, but that Canadian public, and dwindling as it may be from what we know it now, will have put aside or put us on the back burner. That's my fear. But
I think that's what the commission is partly about, don't you, Les?
Well, they're a part of a lot of things, and I think, you know, based on what it is they're going to hear, I do not envy them the task of what it is they're going to have to hear, what it is they're going to have to deal with, and how they're going to take all of what they hear and put it into the report that they're going to deliver.
You talk about starting off dreaming of radio, and here you are as the CEO of a radio station that's a part of building community. In my mind, that signals achievement and success and bringing people together. And I'd love you to just leave us with one thought about what keeps you going.
If I do that, I might have, if I know what that answer is, I might have stopped a long time ago. But I, like I say, I don't know what it is. There's something out there I have to do. I don't know what it is, you know, but there's certain things along the way that I want to achieve, and I don't know them today. I mean, they pop up tomorrow or the day after that, but it's just, it's hard to explain, but it's something that I have to do, and that when I do it and I know it, you know, then I'll figure it out. But right now, I mean, I'm just on a fast track to doing whatever I can as quick as I can.
Well, you're a wonderful community builder. You're a terrific MC, and I thank you very, very much. Thank you, Les Carpenter. We turn now to Pauline Gordon. Both her parents attended residential school. Her mother, Shingle Point, Intense. Her dad, Gruard Residential School in Fort Vermilion. Pauline became an educator because she didn't see herself reflected in the curriculum. That's what led her to education. She's been an educator since 1976 and progressed through to school administration. She was actually in this school until grade 6, from grade 7 to 9 in Grandin. She came back here for grade 10 to grade 12. She's the first Aboriginal superintendent of the school board, as she puts it, the first homegrown superintendent. She became assistant deputy minister, working in policy changes, especially to ensure cultural education. And she's very proud of her brainchild, the Residential School Interagency, all the agencies dealing with residential school and following residential school. I also first met Pauline on a dance floor where she was jigging away.
She's fantastic. Pauline, thank you for being part of this circle.
Thank you.
I'd like to ask you what the word resilience means to you.
I guess as an educator, sometimes you get a sense that the children that you have so much on their plate that there's no way they're going to survive a day in school. So when I taught here in both A Wing and B Wing, which is ironic because I was always in B Wing, until Mr. Elliott started this spelling bee and I got to go see what they did in A Wing that was different, and there wasn't much. But I think some of the kids that came, I would always have crackers and stuff because you just don't know who's had a good breakfast. And I think to me resilience is the ability to just go on despite everything, despite the factors that could hold you down, despite the people like Richard was talking about that could tear you down. There were so many times when I would enter a forum where there were, like here, mostly men, mostly in suits, mostly in ties. So when I became the superintendent of the school board here, I was just one female among men. And then as assistant deputy minister again, one female with men. So sometimes the things that they were saying were quite demeaning. And I know that they were meant to be humorous. But I learned from the students that I taught. I learned that, you know, despite everything, at the end of the day, you have to be able to live with yourself. And so those children that I saw during the day, I spent a lot more time with them than their parents because the education system does that for us, which in retrospect was really good for me here when I was in Grolier because I was blessed with the ability to achieve academically, and then I saw the recognition from the teachers that I didn't get from the supervisors, because if you have like 100 junior girls, there's no way you're going to get the attention. But at school, if you're able to achieve, then somebody's going to pat you on the back, and that's something we never got. And I have to say, having been the eighth of 11 children, my mother could no longer pat me on the back. She lost up until me, seven children, so there was no way she was going to bond with any more of her kids. So it was very, very difficult to go home and try to fit in when you couldn't fit in there and you really didn't fit in the residence. But at the school, I could be called Pauline. I didn't have to be a number. So I excelled because then I knew that the teachers would pay attention to me. So when I became an educator, I tried so hard to make sure that I learned their history of the family, that I went to the home sometimes with report cards, because I wanted to know where they came from. And to me, kind of like Les says, I'm not sure that I achieved that much. I think on paper, yeah, but I'm still trying to find myself. I hid behind titles, like I told Commissioner Littlechild in Fort Smith. I hid behind my titles, kind of like what you said, well, Aboriginal people don't say I'm a CBC reporter. Well, I hid behind those titles because I didn't know who I was. I'm so thankful that my kids have forgiven me. Their playground was this school when they were younger because I taught here. When I went to university, they were there with me. I dragged them across the country, and I really was anal about cleanliness. Like, people laugh about it, but I'm a product of residential school, so Saturday we were cleaning. And I never spent much time with them because I didn't know how. And I'm so thankful that they've forgiven me, that they still call me Mom. But I guess to me, having been in residence was one thing, but going to the whale camp in the summer was my saving grace. Every summer we went to Kendall Island with my parents, and there it was very communal. Inuvialuktun was prevalent everywhere. People shared everything.
There was no such thing as babysitters, because if you were older and you saw a mother being busy and the baby was needed to be changed, you did it. Nobody told you. And so for me, that was always in the back of my mind, that humbleness of being in an environment that could be very harsh, because if it was really windy and stuff, then you were intense, right? But everybody had to do the harvest and stuff. So, and I think it's that thought of, if it's got to be, if it's going to be, it's got to be me, like Robert Schuller says. Because at our fish camp too, like if you didn't pitch in, then you weren't going to have food on the table, you know. And by the time I grew up, my father was paraplegic, so life was extremely hard for us. We were one of the poor families in Iqaluit. And I still, you know, like when I go there, I still get that sense that people think less of the Tarta family because of our family situation. So, and I'm just about crying, so I have to stop.
What sustains you now? What is it that feeds your soul?
You know, people are going to laugh at this, but I watch Oprah over the years, and I've learned so much from her about finding self and being comfortable in my own skin. And honestly, there are days when I... You know, since I've retired, my saving grace was that 4 years before I retired, I took deferred leave, which is like the fifth year off with pay. For the first 2 weeks, I was totally depressed. My daughter-in-law owned a salon, so I volunteered there. She tried to kick me out, but I told her I'd take my son with me. No. So I volunteered there. So now since I've been retired, I volunteer at the Friendship Center. I'm on the national board. I do things whenever I want, wherever I want. So if you want to dance, Sheila, we're there.
I'm in.
Yes. And I love to dance. I love to coordinate things. I'm very good at coordinating and getting money. Oh, I raised $14,000 for our Aboriginal Day. So you can't leave without giving me a dollar here. No. No, and I have grandchildren. Oh my gosh, they've taught me so much about love, because when we went to residential school, my sister was only 5, and sister used to look at us outside from the second floor with a curtain this way, and we would be out at 40 below, and my sister was only 5, and we'd be in skates. So I'd take her skates off, and I'd put her feet in my stomach to warm her up. And when I think of my grandchildren and that... that it could have happened to them. And I told myself I wasn't going to cry. So when I look at them, and my grandson just graduated from the Canadian Forces, I'm so proud of him. And my daughter used to get mad at me, because when I used to tell him, Vaughn, are you smart? And he'd say, yeah. And I used to tell him, no, you're brilliant. And one of his teachers, Lois Lafferty, came to me one time and said, he's learning to brag. And then when he graduated from high school, I went to him and I said, Vaughn, are you smart? And he said, no, I'm brilliant. So now he's graduated from the forces. And then I have 2 little granddaughters that I'm meeting with in a couple of weeks. And it's those 2 that sometimes I see myself. When Lexi talks and she hears me say some Inuvialuktun words, even the bad ones, she copies. And I used to think, how come, you know, when we were in residential school, we didn't copy any of that? Because they never spoke to us. It was always commands. you know, line up for supper, line up for church, line up for this. Goodness sakes, you know, we were just like in the forces, you know. It was, there were some periods where I just wanted to touch an adult, you know, just touch so that I could become a person, you know, not just a number.
Pauline, I think you've learned so much. You were made to be an educator. There's no question. Thank you so much. Thank you, Pauline Gordon. And Pauline, thank you for educating us very much. Paul Andrew is here. Paul Andrew is a former chief, former vice president of the Dene Nation, the founding co-host of Northbeat. So everybody knows Paul. And he's a wonderful, wonderful musician. I learned something from him last night, that George Jones is actually a Dene elder. Please welcome Paul Andrew. Paul, you ended up in broadcasting. Did you dream of television when you were a kid?
Oh, no, not at all. You know, when I was a young man, I was growing out in the bush, living out in the bush, and the thing that they told me more than anything else was, we don't want you to be a good, rich man, famous, or happy man. We just want you to be a good man. Mm. And that's all my mission in life was, to be a good man. And that when my elders become older, I was going to take care of them. And then when I get older, they will take care of me. And the cycle will continue.
You wouldn't
Television
believe...
never, ever thought about that.
There are all nodding when, heads behind you.
When we were growing, when we were going to school here, you know, television came and it was 2 weeks behind. When we were watching a hockey game, hockey was big up here too. We were watching a hockey game and somebody, some idiot would come over and say, I know who won that game. Montreal won 2-1. So they always told us the plot of the hockey game or the TV program long before that. So to think about television at that time was certainly. But the thing that I thought about definitely was that television is certainly storytelling. And that makes it so much, because I come from, and everybody here that I know of, come from such amazing storytelling. You know, so many times I wish I knew Gwich'in. You know, I see some of these Gwich'in ladies, you know, they'd say, Shaka, and then they go, You know, and I envy that. I wish I could, you know, and I listen to some of the Inuvialuit women, you know, they're amazing, you know, and I just wish I had that language skills to be able to sit with them to comprehend that, you know, and so that is the history that I came up with. And so to think about anything that involved technology, even today, iPod, what is that? I don't know.
You went to Grolier, right?
Yeah. I spent 7 years in Grolier Hall here. And I can understand some of the things that people are talking about here. Ran around this gym a lot of times. And this gym was a savior for a lot of things, because we were good at the physical stuff. We were good athletes. We were good at the sports. I don't know about other people. I didn't do very good in classrooms because I didn't have the basics, the background in education. And there was times when I was called dumb and stupid. And there were times when I felt dumb and stupid. But put me in a gym, there was not too many people better than I am. There were some, but not too many better than I am. And so I loved it in the gyms. I loved it on the cross-country trails. I loved it on the hockey arenas, because they made me feel like I'm part of. They made me feel good. But in the education, it wasn't quite the same. And I had the same sense, and I had the same kind of feelings that the other two people were talking about. You know, why was my cousin over there in Grolier Hall, and I'm over here? You know, not too long ago in Kokloktok, I heard a woman talk about the same thing that Les was talking about. We'd go to Grolier Hall, she said, and then by the springtime, when we're going back on the same plane, those cousins of ours, we hated them. We didn't talk to them all the way back home because they were Catholics and we were not, you know? And I remember, wow, that's, so Grolier Hall, it's infamous for a number of reasons, of course, people who know its history. And I went there when I was 8 years old, and I spent a year at 8 years old. And that particular year is a blur. If you ask me about what happened, I wouldn't know, a blur. Like so many of us in here, so many people here, I didn't know what hello meant. I don't know what goodbye meant, let alone study periods or anything like that. And you learn, you know, I guess when you're a young kid, you have to learn to adapt really fast. Because if you don't, you get hit, you know? One of the guys used to tell me, you know, I'm sure that a lot of people, you know, my age, we love movies. Because movies was a fantasy. You know, that 2 hours or so that we watched the movie, we were in the fantasy land. We were not at Grolier Hall or any of the residential schools. So we looked forward to that so much. And if you were bad, you didn't go to see the school. And apparently before my time, if you were just a little bit bad, you could go to school to see the movies, but you had to face the other way. That was Grolier Hall. Who thinks about those kind of punishment? I often wonder who, you know, somebody somewhere sits in a corner desk all by himself in the dark saying, this is how we're going to punish them. But that was Grolier Hall. That was, you know, but the wonderful thing to this day, you know, the music that you talk about. I learned to play guitar watching Louis Goose play guitar. I learned to watching Charlie singing, "You're Cheating Hard." And I always wanted to say that, you know, I wanted to, you know, because Hank Williams is also a Dana Elder, you almost want to say. You know, you always want to say, hey, you're cheating hard. Hey. You know, and the special relationship that I have with Charlie and Louis and all these people around here because of residential schools. We have been to hell and back. And there is a commonality between people who have been to hell and back. And I can go see a student in Kokloktok or anywhere in this part of the country or anywhere in the country and know that we've been to hell and back. And that makes us very, very close. And to me, that's very special. And I know that I have a good job. I've been with CBC for 27 years. And that's because of some of the education I've had. Oftentimes, I have debated between the loss and the benefits of that. And a lot of times, you know, one of the things that I wanted to say, if you had asked me what was resiliency, I would say resiliency is being able to say, sometimes I feel that circle is coming back, that I'm coming back to those days. That sometimes I feel like I'm coming back to those days when the elders were very proud of who they are. They laughed and they have so much fun. They taught us some of the things that Chief Cassie was talking about. They taught us very young so that we'd have a strong mind and a strong heart. That anybody can throw anything at us at any time and we would kick ass. That's what they taught us. And sometimes, not all the time, I feel like we're coming back to that circle again. And that's why for me, to me, today, it's very important. They sing in Inuvialuktun. Those are so, so important because it brings back that pride right in here. right in here. It teaches us about who we are and what we are and where we come from. And there's nobody better than us. Like Nellie Cornway said the other day, you know, if the elders gave up, we would not be here today. But, you know, anything you threw at them, any tough situation you threw at them, they didn't say, oh, it's tough, we better take it easy. No, they tackled it. And, you know, they kick ass. They kick ass really well, you know. And one of the reasons that they did that was because they worked together. They helped each other. And even when the other people came into this country, like the kind of people we are today, they reached out to them. They hugged them and they helped them. And they said, welcome to. Welcome, have our food. Eventually, they took our house. But, you know, we offered them the food. That's the kind of people we are. You know, and sometimes that's what resiliency means to me, is being able to come back that full circle and being proud to be Gwich'in. You know, when I left in the early 1800s?
I shouldn't be asking you about resiliency. It should be your face cream. Well,
what did they put in this water? When I left into early 1980s from here, most of the Inupiaq dancers and singers were old people. And you never heard too much about the Inupiaq dancers. Billy Day, Mr. and Mrs. Gordon, and some of these other people, they were really proud, and they danced and they sang the songs, you know. And about 15 years later, I came back here. And you know where the elders were? They were sitting around the corner where elders should be. And they were watching the younger people dance and sing. That's the way it should be. And that's the way they were doing it. You know, and you could see the pride in these young kids as they were dancing. You know, the other night, you saw this little two-year-old.
Liam.
Liam was fantastic. Liam was proud to be Inupiaq, and he was showing the whole world. And that's what we need to do. We need to not just say we're Inupiaq or Gwich'in or I'm a Shutawatine. We got to sing it. We got to dance those dances like it's the last dance we're going to have. We've got to play those games like it's the last game we've ever had. We've got to talk the Slavey language or the Inupiaq or the Gwich'in language or any of the Aboriginal languages in the North like it's the last time we're going to do it. And we're going to have to show the rest of the world that not only am I proud to be who I am, but I'm proud of the people I come from. You know, and that's, for me, the resiliency. And sometimes I feel like I'm getting there, and I'm really glad to be doing that.
Thank you, Paul Andrew. Very inspiring. Thank you. My first job in radio was as a country and western announcer, and I didn't know the real heritage of Hank Williams and George Jones. See, I'm educated every minute in this circle. It's amazing. Charlie Furlong is a recent addition to our circle today, artist and singer. I love you because you got me up dancing last night. It was a real treat to hear you. And are you going to speak in your language or? Okay. All right. I'll start first of all just by welcoming you to the circle. Thank you for joining us. What would you like to say about resilience, Charlie? Bring your microphone. Yeah, there it is. Love that mic.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Well, before I start, I do have that effect on people whenever I sing, so.
You're not going to sing right now, are you?
But, George Jones is Denny, and I think he's my cousin from Toledo. Because I find the Gwich'in to be bullheaded, and, you know, Inupiaq the same, you know, and very determined, you know. I find the Saatu people lonesome people. And, you know, their heart is big for slow new music, and I'm part Saatu, so I guess that's why I'm that way. But, you know, just Paul talks about talked a little about ourselves and who we are and where we come from and the power of our elders and through a song, you know, and I think that's a good way to express yourself if you can't find the words to do it. And, you know, Paul's show on every Friday talks about the Indian love song. And, you know, that's, you laugh about it, but it really, they really speak about a feeling, feelings for each other. And there's a funny story about Paul's uncle, Fred Andrew. My dad came down from Fort Norman in 1945 to Klavik to hunt muskrat. And there was an old-timer called Jim Firth who loaned him a piece of his trap line. So I guess that night when they stopped to make tea and have some bannock and things like that, there's a lake and nice and calm, and there was a loon making noise. Now, a loon will trigger the loneliness out of any slave any day, you know? But here this loon was making noise, and Fred Andrew all of a sudden got lonesome for Fort Norman. So he started singing a love song. He was right down on his knees singing. And that old Jim Firth was paddling around two lakes from there, and he heard that, and God, he started paddling. He started paddling. He thought somebody was drowning. He came over there and heard my dad and Fred Andrew were both singing that love song. He called them, "You damn crazy fools," he said, you know, "I'm not supposed to do that." But see, that's the kind of feelings you talk about, you know, and resilience, you know, is to be determined to preserve what we should have had. And for that period of our lives, we were denied that. And that's why we're here today. You know, like everybody else, you know, I'm no stranger to abuse, and I put it out of my life years ago. And
How did you do that?
Well, it was hard. I was an alcoholic very young. I started drinking very young. And everybody kept telling me, you know, "Charlie, you're a smart boy, you know, you could do so much, you know, just leave that damn stuff alone." But no, I had to do it, you know, just bullheaded, and maybe that part of Irish in me, I don't know, but maybe that's why I like to drink and dance and sing. But the other half couldn't take it. So, you know, I knew I was smart. I mean, there was no doubt about it. I mean, you know, I could debate with anybody, it doesn't matter, but I just had that one problem, you know, and so I made up my mind. I didn't know what it was that was bothering me, you know, and maybe it was the guilt, you know, the hurt feelings that I had, you know, and I figured if that was it, then, you know, I better push it out of my life and try to move on. And that's what I did. You know, I put that dark period of a little part of my life, I put it on hold. You know, and today I know it doesn't go away. But I wanted to go forward, you know, and I did that. The next problem was alcoholism. And I was married, I had kids already, and so that too, I was pretty close, and I kept on going, "I wouldn't be talking to you today." You know, that's how bad it was. So I quit that. It's been 18 years now. But I wish I had a hangover sometimes, so I'd have an excuse not to work. Just kidding. But no, I wouldn't. And I think a lot of us went through that. A lot of people I went to school with, a lot of younger people, we all went through that. All my friends were alcoholics, drunks. A lot of them died. A lot of them suffered. There was abuse, family abuse, spousal abuse, elder abuse, you name it. It came. I believe today, 63 years old, and I believe that's the effect, and that's that dark period in my life that's sitting dormant right now. That's still brewing there. And over the years, I've learned to be strong in mind, that I can try to control those things. But, you know, I'm afraid someday it might erupt, you know, like an old volcano, and I'm afraid for those around me. But I just hope as I get older that I'd be able to control that. But when I look at the period of my life, and I look at my friends, all these people here that I spend time with, and you know, I see what residential school has done to my society. I see residential school has affected everything in how we live. The Gwich'in language is almost dead. In the Nubialwit, you know, they could speak it. The rest of the Aboriginals still could talk, converse in their language with one another, but it's very rare in the Gwich'in. And to me, that is the basic foundation to any society to become strong, is the language. The language that keeps, it's the glue that binds them together. And without that glue, there's a danger that we're scattered all over. But not only that, you know, I see how that has affected our people. You know, as a leader, a longtime leader, you know, I see how the community, our own society works, how they treat each other. It's not only the Gwich'in, I think it's everybody up and down the valley. I've always believed that the Aboriginal people survived on three basic principles: love, respect, and sharing. That's what I used to hear when I was a kid. I used to hear older people talking, and they talked about that. With love in a family, in a community, you don't hurt somebody that you love. You don't hurt children. You don't hurt elders. You won't have that if you people took that basic principle and practice it. Respect. You know, you don't talk about other people who you respect. You know, you don't take things from people that you respect them. You know, these things. And you respect what other people have. I go to Fort Liard once in a while, and there's an old tradition there that when somebody leaves his house, he puts a broom handle on the door. They don't lock the door. They put a broom handle, and so everybody knows that nobody is home. God, have you tried that around here? That's open season, you know? But see, that's what I mean. That's respect. And then there was sharing. People shared things amongst one another. Elders never went hungry because people shared. A widow never went hungry because people shared. Your sisters or brothers never went hungry because if you're a good hunter, you shared. And that's what kept the people together, the society. It became a strong society because the family unit was strong. And with a strong family unit, you had a strong community and strong leaders, because people picked those leaders for those qualities they had.
You know. What have you taken from that?
Pardon?
What have you taken from all of that?
Well, as a leader, I've always, you know, tried to practice those principles, you know, and tried to make a difference for people. You know, I've talked to elders, and, you know, they've told me these things. And to me, in our society today, that is what is missing. There's so much jealousy, hatred, you know, and those things within our communities that you know, if you become a leader, you also become a moving target for criticism and all backstabbing, you name it, it's all there. I mean, 70 years ago, our people never had that. You know, and look at the change from that period to where we are today. And so to me, that's what residential school did to us, you know. And I think, you know, we have to take a look back as a collective. And we have to look at where did we go wrong? At what period of time did we actually go wrong and take a left turn to where we are today? You know, I believe that's less said, you know. Sure, it's easy, you know. Words are a dime a dozen. Prime Minister Harper said, I'm sorry. But what's the next step? You know, what are they going to do? I mean, it just to say I'm sorry and then to hell with the natives for another 100 years. To me, that's what it means, that apology. And unless government is willing to take the first step and make a change in attitude towards Aboriginal people and change some of those policies that they have, then I think, you know, Aboriginal people and the government's crown can start working together to respect each other's culture, language, and tradition. And without it, you know, it's a circle. Well, you know, the next generation of leaders, Gwich'in people, it's the same, going to be the same thing. You know, that hate, jealousy, and mistrust of each other is going to continue with the next generation. And to me, that's the greatest fear I have, you know, for my society and for the Aboriginal people as a collective.
And is that one of the reasons you're an artist and a musician?
Well, to me, you know, I learned long ago that music and dancing is something to loosen up the people, you know, and things like that. And I can express myself a lot more through music. And, you know, tomorrow I'll be showing a little PowerPoint here that, you know, I'm a wimp when it comes to talking about my residential school and things like that. I get very emotional. And I don't think I can stand up and talk to the people about it, you know. And, you know, to me, a Gwich'in warrior never cries, and so I don't want to cry in front of the people. But I did my life in residential school in that piece. And in the background, I've shown pictures of the residential school. And also, I did an intro in which you'll hear Les Carpenter speaking. He mentioned CHAK, Klavik, was a very important communications link to the people in the days. And in that time, you would hear a message from the Indian agent to the families out in the bush to get their children ready because the boats are going to pick them up. And we set that as messages and things like that. And also, again, I showed people that used to sing on the radio station. I mentioned their names. So that'll be showing tomorrow. Okay. And so, you know, I hope people would like it, you know, because that's my story and my life in a song. So that's the way I want to express it. And other than that, you know, that as a leader for many years, I've tried to watch people, tried to watch how they're evolving, you know, what's bothering them, you know, and we seem to react a lot of times to situations and not be proactive. And it's not our fault too a lot of times, you know. Many of us are governed, even in our own homes, by policy, government policy. We can't do nothing without barging head on into some sort of policy that tells, no, you can't do this or you can't do that. And so, you know, there's a big change that needs to happen, and it needs all the players, government, Aboriginals, you know, we need to help. You know, we need to work together. But I don't know that'll ever happen because I've never ever seen it in my 30 years of politics, eh? But other than that, it's... despite all that, all I would like to say, and what some of these other people said, is that we are a happy people. You know, there's no doubt about it. You know, when you sit around a cafe or you're traveling the bush or anything, the stories that the people tell, a lot of laughter. That's the way it is. We're a laughing people, you know, and we talk about it, that. We talk about each other in a good way. Everybody's got a story on somebody. You know, even years ago, like in Iqaluit, it was a very mixed community, and still is today. But in those days, there's no Inuvik, but there's a story there about some of the natives there were concerned that too many white people were coming into town. And it became a concern to the chiefs, but people were used to, you know, working together. But anyways, I guess the discussion came to a point where, well, we're going to kick all the white people out. Anyways, but in Iqaluit had everything, you know. And so anyways, I guess it came on the, nobody knew what an agenda meant, you know, but it came a discussion point. But anyways, it came up and, yeah, we're going to kick all the people, all the white men out. You know, we need to vote on it. So the vote came and everybody is in favor of kicking the white people out, and some people's hands went up. But one fella, he got up, he said, no, 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 no. And he said, we can't kick those white people out. And the chief said, why? Who in the hell are we going to steal gas from? He said. So.
And on that note.
Thanks for the opportunity to speak in the circle.
I wanted to say thank you so much, Charlie Furlong. Charlie, you make a great point. I think for many, many Canadians who have never been in the company of Aboriginal people, that they're depriving themselves of a great experience and often so much laughter. I've laughed my ass off, except I saw it in the mirror last night and it's still there. It's just, I'm just so disappointed. Grandma Susie's with us, speaking of laughter and great humor. So wonderful to see you, Sharon. Thank you very much, Charlie. Senator Nick Sibiston is our next panelist, our next guest. Welcome to the circle. A lawyer, a distinguished member at one point of the Northwest Territories Legislature, needless to say, a senator now, former premier, justice specialist, cultural advisor for the television program North of 60. That's fantastic. Boy, I love thinking about advising Tom Jackson. But getting back to business, Mr. Sibiston and his wife Karen, who I had the pleasure of meeting today, presently operate a family bed and breakfast, and they have 6 children, of whom they're very proud. Thank you very much for being with us today.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you.
When I knew that we were going to be talking about resilience...
You wrote a few notes.
I thought about it.
Okay.
And then I made a few notes. So I define resilience as your human spirit being able to survive or cope with very difficult traumatic events in your life. And that's how I describe it.
How does that fit for you?
You're throwing me off my script.
I know.
Can you just let me, if I'm bored or lost, lead me back.
All right, okay. But I'm really interested in your personal story.
I am. That's what my wife told me, too. She says, just leave that paper and talk from the heart.
Your wife is right. She is. I understand the comfort of paper, however, I really do.
Okay, I did not have a father, only my mother and grandmother. My mom got TB and had to go to Campbell Hospital in Edmonton. And at 5 years old, she put me on a mission boat to go to Providence, where I was there for 6 years. And I didn't know a word of French because the sisters talked to us in French. My original language is Slavey. And also, it wasn't going from a home to another home. It was going from a house to an institution. And the routine there on arrival was you're given a bath and you're de-liced and you're given a haircut and all your clothes are taken away. I know I arrived with a little bag that my mother had filled with winter things, you know, your mitts, your winter. But all of that was taken away and put up high in the cupboard, and we didn't see it again till next June. And the wear was coveralls and one set of pants and shirt for school. As a child, the normal reaction when you're in distress is when you're sad, when you're lonely and hurt, miss your mother, grandma, is to cry. In residential school, you quickly learn that you should not cry. If you cry, you're teased, you're shamed out, you're even punished. So you brace yourself and learn not to cry. You have to be a big boy, you have to toughen up. And I remember Sister Shampoo, when I had been there a few years, and when we would get there in the fall, for the first few days, some of us would cry. And Sister would give us an empty sardine can to put our tears in. You know, and that was the treatment. And I've always thought, you know, what's so hard about just putting your hand on a child and saying, don't cry, don't be sad, you know, but there was never anything of that. And I've always thought and have now in my older life become very cynical of the sisters. You know, they come north as big sisters of charity. You know, they devote their lives to God. But when it comes down to dealing with children, they couldn't even love us. They're dressed in big cloaks. They have these things around their face. Everything to separate themselves from the world and from us kids. And so I'm pretty angry about that, thinking, you know, couldn't they love us? Couldn't they have shown us affection? But it never happened. And so you begin building a shell around you to protect yourself. All natural feelings of loneliness, homesick, sadness, fear are suppressed and covered up. And the yearning and need for love, hugs, and affection, and affirmation by your mother or father are no longer there. And you learn to live without these things, and you become very resilient.
So, how did you learn to become resilient, and how has it played through in your life now?
Well, I was just going to say that. So I came out of residential school. I did survive, and I was resilient, and I think if you weren't resilient, you would die as a little child. And but resilience, as we know it as a young person, follows you and it's be part of you as you become an adult. And so when you come out of residential school, you come out of there tough, got a thick skin, you've learned to live without love and learned to suppress your emotions. And I soon learned that as I became an adult, that these things that make you resilient as a child were no longer good qualities for me as an adult. And I had to change. You have to be able to cry. You have to be able to love and be loved. You have to be able to express your emotions and take down that thick cover that you have to protect yourself. And I'll just relate this to my adult wife. And I met Karen, who is here. And I give credit for us being still married. Soon after we got married, after the euphoria and excitement of being married, and Karen said that I was cold. I couldn't show love, and she could not penetrate and get through to my emotions. I couldn't love. And Karen was pretty feisty, and I remember many times at night when she wanted to talk to me about something, all I wanted to do was go to sleep. And she would open the windows, this is in the wintertime, open the windows and tear the blankets off me, you know? And that was her way of making me, you know, deal with her. And oftentimes the result would be, if we didn't talk, at least we said, okay, we'll talk about it tomorrow, you know? And but that's her way of dealing with me. As I said, you know, I couldn't express my emotions. She said she couldn't penetrate and get through to me. And it reminds me of a friend who was very similar to me, who had been in school, residential school, even longer. And he got married. And after about 2 years, they separated. And when we talked to her, she says, I can't get through to the guy. He just can't express himself. He, you know, can't get anything out of the guy, mainly because he had obviously built such a big, thick skin around himself that he wouldn't let anybody else, particularly his wife, get through to him. So she couldn't put up with that, and she left him. In our case, Karen was very patient with me, and it took a lot of time. We went for a lot of counseling and marriage encounters, and really worked at it over the years, so that now we get along reasonably well. We get along better now than in the first year of marriage, I think. Now, as to career, I went to university, got a Bachelor of Arts law degree, and I practiced for a while. And I got into politics and challenged the status quo of the 70s and 80s, very vocal for Native people. I became minister and government leader and premier during that time. I eventually left politics, and we built a bed and breakfast, and lastly became a senator. But all of these was done with a lot of guts and determination. It wasn't easy. And as an adult, I had to deal with myself, learn new ways to cope, survive, and be resilient. And in terms of my drinking, I went to Natsijik AA in Hay River for 35 days. And for many years, I went to AA meetings, an adult child of alcoholics. And during my married life, I always felt like a bird that was suddenly put in a cage. That's to me what marriage was for me. And I soon realized after I got married, well, you know, you just can't go out all night and party like you used to. You know, and you had to come home with your wife, you know. And so those are things that I had to deal. And in the course of our marriage, I don't mind saying that I was unfaithful to my wife. And We went through a lot of counseling, Christian counseling. We went down to Elijah House in Idaho for Christian marriage counseling. And fortunately, Karen was forgiving, and that's the reason that we're still together. Now, there was another issue in my life was of having no father. For a long time, I thought I was like Jesus, you know? No father, you know? And everything happened by the Holy Spirit, you know? And in the 80s, I finally took the guts to ask my mother. And it's a very sensitive issue, you know? Never talk about that. But I finally, one time where I was driving with her to Yellowknife on the highway, and I knew, well, she couldn't get out and run away. We were driving. And so I asked her, I said, "Setalai mionte," like, my father, who was he? And she says, "Sondi," which means I don't know, you know? And so I thought about it in a while, and I thought, you know, I told her, "Kiat ele." I said, "I'm not a dog. I want to know who my father was," you know? And so eventually she says, "Dalzell. Never heard of this guy." You know, because my aunts and uncles said, "Well, your father was an American soldier when they were building the airport in the 40s. They always told me, "Well, that's your father." You know, but I guess my mother, they never really asked my mother. And I know these things don't happen in the light of day. You know, they happen late at night and usually under drinking circumstances, you know. And funny, I had an uncle, a Danish fella, and when I told him that my mother said it was Dalzell, and he kind of thought about it and scratched his head, and he says, "I didn't know Mr. Dalzell was like that." No, that's what his response was, eh? Anyway, after I became a senator, I pursued it a little more vigorously and found out that George Dalzell, he was a white man, and I found out that he was a hunter and trapper. He was eventually got a plane, and he trapped up in the mountain, the Hanny Mountains, using plane. And I guess the policemen and government officials didn't like that, so they went all the way to Ottawa to change the game laws and saying you can't use plane to go trapping. But I thought, wow, you know, if it's going to be like that, I was glad it was him, because he was a hunter and trapper, and he was always one step ahead of the law. You know, and I like that about the fact that he was like that, you know, and maybe I got some of those genes, you know. And the other issue that I dealt with is that ever since I was young in residential school, kids were used to tease me because I was fairer than the others. I had brown hair and little fair, and you know how it is in a crowd. If you're a little bit different, you get picked on. And so I had that through a lot of my residential school. But in my heart, I was always a Dene, because I was raised by my mother and grandmother who were Dene. And so in the early 90s, I got my mother to register with a ban. And because she had been adopted, she was a Métis, but she was adopted by Joe Hope, who was a chief in Simpson in the 30s. And so she was able to be registered, and then I registered. So I was very happy and proud that I was a Dene and a band member in Simpson. And every year, for the last few years, I take my mom. My mom is 90. And she's in an old folks home in Simpson. And every year, I take her out, and we go when there's treaty payment. So we get in the lineup, and we go and get our $5 each, you know, as a, and so it's a bit of a ceremony there, but good.
Senator.
Just about done.
Okay.
And in the late 80s, in the mid-90s, long before residential school issue was public, a number of us used to meet every year at a tribal council, and we would get together, and we had all been in residential school, and we would say to each other, you know, we've got family, we got everything, we got a job, you know, we got health, you know, and but we were not happy. And it seemed as if there was something missing. And we all eventually related this unhappiness to residential school. And the very first gathering we had, the theme was, I just want to be happy, you know? And that's what we strove for, to find this little measure, little bit of happiness that normal people had, but because I think we had been in residential school, we didn't have that. The other thing too is, so since the late 1900s, as soon as the Aboriginal Healing Foundation came into existence, we applied for money and set up a society, and for quite a number of years we had a program where we had workshops and we had a field workers and we had annual gatherings and talked about residential school. And every time we talked about it, we felt better. And it's not rocket science. You just sit in a circle like this and take your turns. And in when we would hear each other's stories and benefit from that. And we would all feel better after we've had a session. So in my marriage and in my career, I've had to deal with myself and undo the effects of residential school and find new ways to cope. As I said, the mechanisms that I developed as a child to survive no longer were good. They were no longer functioned well for me as an adult. So I spent a lot of my time in my adult life undoing the things that I learned as a child to survive. And I just think that when I think about my life, the first 5 years of my life when I was home were just the best. An idyllic life, you know, very, I lived with my mother and grandmother, and they took good care of me. They had a good clothes, you know, moose hide shoes and mitts and so forth. And my mother, when I would go out in the winter time and go to the snares with my grandmother, she would even go to the extent of getting a cloth, heating it up, and putting it in my pants so my family jewels wouldn't freeze or get cold, you know? So that's the extent to which my mother looked after me.
Six children later.
So I'm 67 years old, yep. And I have found a measure of peace in my life. Karen and I are getting along very good. And in my elder's age, I become very holy. I don't sin anymore like I used to when I was young. But there is a sadness, and I do suffer from depression, and I have to take antidepressants, you know, to keep kind of on the cool so I don't go off the rails. You know, go throw a fit or throw, yeah.
Yeah.
So. Okay, thank you.
All right, Senator, thank you very much. Thank you very, very much. And thank you to Karen, who I feel you were sort of a supporting actress in this in the senator's dissertation. Jack Anowak is a former federal politician born in Repulse Bay, former mayor of Rankin Inlet, an ambassador for Circumpolar Affairs. He argued for Nanuk instead of the loony that became our dollar, right? Too bad. Sometimes the wrong choice is made, as we know. And I know Jack as a courageous face of mental illness. I think it was 3 or 4 years ago, during Mental Health Awareness Week, Jack was named a face, and it has meant that he's come forward and spoken publicly about his own deep sadness that was a result of his upbringing, going to residential school. So I'm very, very proud to welcome Jack Anowak to this circle.
Thank you. When we discuss this topic of resilience, how do you move on with resilience? For example, when I was 35 years old, perhaps back in 1985, for example, my adoptive mother and my other stepmother and my biological mother, after they passed away at the age of 35, and my two younger brothers have committed suicide. When I was 6 years old, my mother passed away. So how do you deal with resilience? So at that time, I believe that many of us learned the cope.
I was explaining. By the time I was 35, I'd lost my adopted mother, my stepmother, and my natural mother, and two of my brothers to suicide. So resilience, you know, you keep going on about how to move forward and learning to live with what you have, learning to live with what you know. September 1959, September was an event occurred that was to have a profound impact on my life. Just before I was nine years old, I went to Chesterfield Inlet for the first time to the residential school. To forever leave the kind of life I had prior to going to Chesterfield Inlet, because even if I went back to it, I was now going to be, for a sake, able to speak English. And by being able to speak English, we thought, we're wiser than our parents. You know, that's what we thought. A lot of us thought, just because we could speak a little bit of English, we're smarter than our parents. And we went on that, except my dad knew English, so we couldn't fool him, but that's another story. That was the change that occurred, because we were no longer going to live as we lived before. Prior to going to Chesterfield Inlet, we were living in igloos, sod huts, tents in the summertime. This is 1959. We didn't get any houses in Repulse until 1963, I think, were the first ones. The only houses, the only buildings were there were the Roman Catholic Church and the Hudson Bay. So we had to, when we went to Chesterfield Inlet, we suddenly, as was pointed out earlier by several of the people who spoke ahead of me, there was no love. There was no feeling. It was just supervisory for the nuns that went there. It was just, they supervised us, they told us what to do, they told us when to do it, they told us how to do it, And we didn't even have to think. We didn't even have to feel. And to top it off with the fact that you weren't allowed to see your, you couldn't even talk to your sibling except maybe once a week on a Sunday for 1 hour or something. That was just a feeling that. And so I had a sister or two sisters that lived a floor above us. I saw them at school at times, but couldn't speak to them because it was forbidden. And we weren't allowed to speak. Inuktitut as well. So all throughout that time, we were undergoing a period of some disenfranchised, whatever the term is from our parents, because not only were we learning English, but we were also learning about the world outside of in my case, Repulse Bay. We were starting to think like how we were supposed to think, like white people, assimilation. We wanted everything in nice little box instead of rounded with no sharp edges. When you go through hardships, and if you're still here, it means you didn't give up. That's what it's all about. It means getting up again. When you fall down, when you're a little boy, you fall down, you get up. Well, the same thing. If you're going through some hardships, we lost hundreds of young people to suicide because there was not enough mental health facilities to respond to their needs, that they were not mentally handicapped. They just had some problems that they had to deal with, which could have been dealt with through going to mental health coordinator or mental health people. We lost a lot of those people. Some people because they didn't want to, they were afraid to go before the court because of a charge outstanding. They killed themselves. Killing yourself is a permanent thing, whereas even if you went to jail, you're still going to come back. It means having a heart. It means having a heart. It means caring for other people, volunteering, taking. I volunteer at the Kamatsiato Crisis Line twice a week for each line and maybe once a week for the crisis line. And you may not get a call for five times you're there, but that sixth time you're there and you get a call, it's worth all those five other call or times you didn't get any calls. Ten times you may not get a call, but it's always worth it when you get a call and you respond to that person in a positive way. But throughout all that time, I remember who, I don't know who it was, but I have a real problem with authority figures. I have a real problem with that. I just think if somebody's quoting me some law, I know it's some guy who made the law up, you know, some guy who thinks just like I do, but thinks differently. And so you think of the authority figures, maybe because we were so much under, we went from a very communal type of living to suddenly a hierarchical level where the bishop and the priests and the nuns and the brothers and all that, all of a sudden it was like that and somebody was in charge. Well, yeah, there may have been somebody in charge in a community or a camp, but nobody went around to say, Mr. Chair, or, you know. but those are the kind of things made us able to forget. But remember, if our parents, when we were growing up, if our parents did not get if they didn't get anything during that hunt, we might well go hungry. Maybe not the next day, but the day after. So we had to hunt in order to survive, and that was, to me, enough to follow, enough of an example for us to follow, that even when you're very, when you're down and out, you don't give up, because tomorrow could bring something more. Throughout all that time, another event occurred in 1975, which was to have a profound impact on my life. I met Caroline, my wife, 35 years ago. We met 36 years ago, and we started planning all sorts of things. We decided we're going to have a baseball team. We're past that. I think we have two teams now. We decided all sorts of things, but at that time, we were just getting from being a settlement to being Hamlet. So we were learning about politics. We were very busy. We were young. We were energetic. We traveled a lot. But she was always an inspiration to me. She was my worst critic, my best advisor, and to quote, how do you, I never say quote, quote. How do you say quote? Q-U-O-T-E, quote.
You did it,
whatever. To paraphrase King Edward, whatever number he was, because I noticed that all the religious leaders of the Anglican Church and the Catholic Church are all just numbers. John Paul II, Benedict XVI, Queen Elizabeth II, and Edward VI. Anyway, to quote King Edward, the guy who abdicated from the throne, when he talked about Wallace Simpson, and I'm just paraphrasing, all that I've been able to do would not have been possible without the help and support of the woman I love. And that, to me, is Caroline, who has the energy of 10 people. Like I said, very hard on me at times, but you learn from it. And so we have had ups and downs. We've had problems with our kids, of course, all kids. Kids think I'm the bank at times. Other times they think I'm the taxi driver, all these things. But throughout it all, they're still our kids. We try and show them the kind of support they need and the love they need to try and do what I was not able to do, because we lost our ability to be much more personal, to be much warmer. But now, I mean, you can take me away from my grandsons anymore, because I love them so much. But it's that kind of thing where the people who were teaching us, now, on top of all that, I love school. I love school. I love reading. So in 1967, when the priest decided that I shouldn't go back to school, to Churchill, in Repulse, he told my parents, and the priest had that influence over my parents. I love reading, but there was nothing to read in Repulse in 1967, except either the nurse or maybe the priest had all these Harlequin romance novels. They're only Harlequin romance novels. That's all there was. Yeah. And the other magazines, that's True Love and all these other old magazines. That's all there was to read in Repulse. So here I am, a hunter at 17 years old, going out seal hunting and caribou hunting and reading Harlequin novels. But that's how I learned to read. That's how I did not give up on my, because when I left school, I just finished grade 8 and wanted to go back into high school. But it shows, you always think, if you get stuck, one of the things that people sometimes find, other people who are with me if we get stuck or something. I'll just stop. We're stuck. We'll get out. And one lady said to me one day, "You didn't even swear." And I said, "Do you think my swearing was going to take the truck out of the sand there? There's no point." So it's that kind of thing of saying to your kids, look, it's all right to get mad, it's all right to do all sorts of things, but be always, like as other people have said, treat other people. No, we have the same golden rule that everybody else thinks they invented, the golden rule. As Aboriginal people, we have the first golden rule. But anyway, so we're at the point now where one time this lady asked me, "Well, how you're being a member of parliament and all these, how do you define success?" And I said, I'm only 60 years old. I'm a young man according to a lot of other people, you know. So I haven't even begun to live yet. So it's a matter of keeping a positive mind, knowing that if you're going through some hardship, most times it's just a matter of time before you get past it. Or if you're, like the same thing with my talking about, I think it was Jean Chrétien who said, if you get stuck in the snow, you keep go back and forth, and you'll get out there somehow. Same thing. You don't give up because maybe 10 minutes, half an hour, you'll be out of there anyway. So, Kuyanamik, thank you very much.
Jack Anouak, thank you very much. Kianunyi. Robert Alexie, Robert Arthur Alexie Jr. has the microphone now. He was born in Fort McPherson. He lives in Inuvik. He served as tribal chief of the Tweltwit Gwich'in of Fort McPherson. Hard to believe I do this for a living, eh? But I do. Also the vice president of the Gwich'in Tribal Council for 2 terms and now works with the Gwich'in Land and Water Board. I know Robert as an author of a book I think every Canadian should read, Porcupines and China Dolls. He read the preface from it last night. Robert, thank you very much for joining us this afternoon.
Thank you.
The idea of resilience to you, you're a word man. What does it mean to you?
Let me read. No. I didn't put too much effort into trying to think what resilience means. I think a couple of these speakers already mentioned the ability to bounce back when you're being put down, walked upon, shot down, and it's that ability to keep getting up, and despite what the world and others seem hell-bent on doing to you. I, unlike a lot of the people at this gathering, and I mentioned this the other day, is I didn't go to residential school until I was 14. My dad, when my sister was old enough to go to school, came in off the land and got a full-time job in the community with the Power Corp. And that was so his children wouldn't have to go to any mission school, residential school, hostel, hall, whatever you want to call it. And we didn't. And growing up in Fort McPherson and watching people, young
young children going to Fleming Hall. I remember a couple, and this only came to me a couple weeks ago, is not once during that time was I envious of them. So because I grew up in a home that it was strict. A lot of tough love. And it definitely made me who I am today. And growing up very athletic, some people would call very intelligent. But you're put down because of that by your own peers. So there came a time in my life when I did enough to get by and no more. And this even carried on well into my adult life. I remember going to Fort Smith to attend a program to become an observer communicator at small airports in the north. And the final test is 50 questions. And when I did that test, I knew that I was going to get 100. So I deliberately made one mistake.
Why?
I didn't want people to think I was intelligent. Then they'd put you down. When I finished grade 8 in Fort McPherson, and I had to come to Inuvik, of all the students that came from McPherson, I was the only one put into the matriculation program, the smart kids. And the 4 years I spent here, I learned to do enough to get by and no more. And that was a result of being considered intelligent or smart. And I didn't like that. Even to this day, I still don't feel comfortable with that. And maybe that's why in my career, rather than get way up here, I get here, and then I do something stupid to bring me way down here, just so I can move back up again, do something stupid again, and get down here. So resilience to me is that ability to bounce back. And even today, a lot of people can look at me and say, well, you got a good job. You're okay. But I'm not. I know that. I deal with a lot of personal issues that I got to deal with. But that's personal. In my job, I think I'm pretty good at what I do. A lot of people would go a little further. I mean, I like to keep tabs on everything. And my board can tell you, I can go back to my office today and I could tell them right on the penny how much funds we got in the bank. Because that's how much I wanna keep control, if you will. And not allow things to go wrong. But in my personal life, I still have a lot of issues to deal with. And despite the fact that I didn't go to residential school until I was 14, I still dealt with the effects of this so-called intergenerational and the tough love shown to me by my dad, who does not talk about it. My mom, who passed away 10 years ago, had nothing but good things to say. But resilience, the ability to bounce back, and to me it sounds sort of sick in a way, is that in order to bounce back, you have to fall. And in order to fall, you have to do something. And majority of the things that happened to me, I do it to myself. And I still have a lot of personal issues to deal with, and one of the things I don't mind mentioning it is I am going through the independent assessment process. I do have two incidents that happened to me when I was very young, and for most people out there, I was never admitted or spent a night in Fleming Hall, but something happened to me there. I have to deal with that. I never lived at Grolier Hall, but something happened to me there. I have to deal with it. And to me, dealing with that and coming to terms with that and the ability to speak about it, even if it means talking to a tribunal behind closed doors with no one but my lawyer there, and that, then at least it's talking about it. And that's something that's just a little bit of what I have to deal with. I mean, a lot of people don't know that. And just in closing, I want to thank the commission for inviting me to the concert last night, and that gave me the opportunity to tell a very important story in my life. And it's about my friend. And the fact that he took his own life, and for whatever reason, that was something very important to me to do. So I thank you very much. Merci.
Thank you, Robert. How are you doing? The most patient man in the room is sitting right beside me. Stephen Kakwi was born at a traditional Dene bush camp near Fort Good Hope. We all know him as a former premier of the Northwest Territories, Dene Nation president, an advocate and an activist for his people and for his land. And from the time of the Mackenzie Valley pipeline in the 1970s, when the debate was going on, he became very socially engaged, as we know. He's married. His wife is in the room. They have three children and grandchildren, right? Yes. Four grandchildren? Congratulations. Stephen, aside from getting through and waiting to speak, what does resilience mean to you?
Well, I'm okay with all the definitions that you read and Nick and my friend Jack Anowak. But there's a crazy side to everything, and I'm thinking, you know, we're so damn resilient. You know, after all the things that the different churches did to us, we're still right there bouncing back, loving them with all our hearts, you know. Like, you got to be crazy to do that. But that's what we're all doing. You know, the nuns have taken their habits off. They're sitting amongst us. And we seem to be okay with that. Now, that's resilience, I would say, you know. There's a part of me that says, you know, the hell with them. But I'm on a crazy journey as well. There's just a short way to put it, and that is, I think all my life I've been involved in a war. People came to this land and took it over, took our kids, took over our land and our families, our communities, and every one of us sitting in here been fighting to get it back. And things come to an end sometime. For me, I guess I had enough of it. You know, I was in politics. And I don't want to make fun of my friends here, but, you know, growing up, there was a lot of leaders that I saw. And every one of them had all the answers. And I always amuse myself. I say, you know, I can't remember a time when I could ever say anything to Nick Sabison, because he already knew everything. He already had all the answers. He knew what we were going to do. When I talked to my friend Richard Nerissu, the same thing. Richard always had all the answers, couldn't tell him anything. And then nobody ever agreed. Jack Anowak, you know, Peter Atenuar, Peter Ernick, Charlie Furlong. We all had the answers. We knew what we were going to do. Nobody agreed with each other, but in the end, I think, in order to survive, we all said, okay, let's get something done together. And that's how it worked. So I always thought, geez, I could do that too. You know, I could stand up and say, I know all the answers and I know what to do. And as long as I didn't get engaged with everybody else, we'll be all right. It's confidence building in a crazy way, you know. But the truth of it is, a lot of us that came out of residential school didn't know anything. Lost our languages, lost our families, lost our communities. I did. You know, and today I talk to my older brother, and he tells me, I remember, this is what my dad said. So I remember a story that my dad said. That's where I'm getting it from. He'd tell me stories about the elders that he grew up with while I was away at school. After 7 years. I came home from Good Hope. I figured I'm never going to leave again. I get to stay home. But there was nothing there. You know, I was no longer 12 years old. I was 18. They didn't want me around. I had enough kids to feed. There's no bed. There's no room in the house. The things I was interested in didn't mean a thing in Good Hope in 1969. Whether it was Bob Dylan or the Beatles or the Rolling Stones or the Black Panthers and the Civil Rights Movement, South Africa, Castro, they didn't care about that. They were trapping, hunting, fishing for lush across the river. Didn't fit in. And so I left again. It saved me the illusion that this is my hometown, this is my people, this is my family. But the fact is I didn't fit in. 60 years old today, and I know, like Good Hope, that's where I was born. But I'm not seen as from there. And I'm okay with that now. I don't spend a lot of energy trying to feel included, be included anymore. I come and go as I please, and I stay when I want, I leave when I want. When the chief wants me to do something or support him, I do that. Resilience. You know, if you don't belong somewhere, then you'll find a place that you do. Bouncing back. All the residential school thing, a lot of us, we became a different kind of family. Ernie Bernhardt. I always remember Ernie because I went to Grandin with him when I was 12 years old. And Ernie was like a big brother. He was amused and used to like having me around because I was so young. And one day, a week after I got to Fort Smith, I had a meltdown because I realized I wasn't going to go home for 10 months. And I was homesick. And my older brother didn't know what to do with me. And so Ernie came up to the third floor and walked in the room. I was probably laying on the bed or the floor bawling my eyes out. And Ernie, in his usual brisk way, walked right up, looked at me and said, "What's wrong with him?" My brother said, "He's homesick." "He'll get over it," he said, turned around and walked back out. And I think that's how we were. You know, every kid that came after that, that's what we all said. "He'll get over it." No hugs, nothing. No comfort. Everything that I think happened in the residential schools, we picked it up. We didn't get any hugs. "You ain't going to get one out of me, I'll tell you that." The nun used to say, "You know, Steve, you don't listen. You're just like a devil." And I often wondered about it. You know, you go through depression and all these things and you think, maybe she was right. You know, as a 9-year-old, maybe I was a devil. Why else would I be punished by a nun? Why would she hit me? Why would she beat me? I must be so bad that God's people would do that. And as you grow up, you often wonder, you know, maybe you are. If you hate none so much, and the church and the government. Maybe she was right. Whatever the case is, a friend of mine phoned the other day and said, Steve, I'm not going to the event in Inuvik. He said, because I'm not willing to forgive. I hate him too much to forgive. The damage they did to us is too much. He said, I can't forgive that. And I said, well, that's, you will do what you want to do. But I know in my heart, you know, after 20 years in politics, I often said, you know, we're pretty hard on each other as chiefs and MLAs and leaders. But none of the things that we've done to each other compare to the abuse that we went through in residential school. So politics is nothing. It's almost fun. But there comes a time when you don't want to do it anymore. As I said, I always thought this whole thing was just a great big war. We lost total, complete control. And as a little kid, I was under that total, complete control of other people that hated me. So all my life, I fought to get it back. And I thought myself as a warrior. I'm going to fight. And I'm going to be just as smart and stubborn and determined because I want to win. So after 20 years, when I left, I remember sitting in the kitchen of my house. I didn't have a thing to do. Just this incredible rage and hate, I guess that's what it is. What do you do with that? You can't even sit still. You know, there's no peace. You can't sleep. There's nobody to forgive. It was a war. And I was the casualty at the end because I didn't have the skills to stay home day after day and have a normal life with my children and my wife. And the marriage fell apart. For 3 years we were separated. I went through a pretty massive depression. I went to a doctor who said I was and I should get medicated. And I chose and said not to, and I thought, I don't want to tell anybody about it. But I got myself here, I'm going to get myself out. And so what I did was I talked to people that I knew who had lost husbands, wives, children, people who had relatives just pass away, people who were dealing with cancer. I thought, how do you cry and how do you grieve? How are you supposed to feel and behave when you're trying to find yourself? And that's what I did for a long time, and I think that's where all the songs and lyrics came from as well. The foolishness of trying to do everything by myself. Didn't want to tell anybody. I always said I never had a lot of friends, and I always acted like it. But I think as children, it's children and people that love you that can help you to survive. And learn how to be hugged, how to hold hands, which is really simple. Simple things like that. We went to an airport one time when my daughter, one of my daughters was quite young. She was about probably 9 years old, and we passed three or four nuns who were dressed in a habit, and she was on a little cart, and I was pushing her. And we passed her, and she said, "Dad, how come you hate them so much?" I didn't say a word. But little kids, they notice these things. And to my friend who phoned me the other day and said, "I'm not ready to forgive yet. I know why I have to, is because my children get afraid of me. My mother once cried and said, you know, Steve, how come you have no heart? You don't love your family, don't love your sisters. But little kids know when you're angry and when you hate. They feel it too. It's not respect, it's just fear. They just get scared of you. And I know that I've always had this really stone face frown on me that once I really realized it was true, I didn't want it anymore. And so I've been actually working really hard the last 10 years to smile more often. I see I'm getting really good at it for the cameras. But also to be able to laugh, and I think, you know, people like my friend Paul Andrew and William Greenland, they bring laughter, George Tucker, bring laughter into my life. And I don't really want to preach to people. I don't think I have a lot of answers for anybody, but I just want to tell you a little bit about what I did. And I know George Tucker has been a good friend of mine for many years, and he once took my brother-in-law fishing, a man who was burdened with many things. So George took him out to this fish lake, and the first morning, took him for a walk and took him to this little island and said, "We're going to go fishing for the next 2 days. That's why you came 2,000 miles. He said, "But I'm going to ask you for something." He said, "I got this little box here." He said, "I want you to put all the things you don't need in this box. Everything that's bothering you, all your worries, all your problems at work, your fears, things you're angry about. So put it all in a box." And he said, "If you really miss it and you want it back, you can come back in 2 days and we'll give them all back to you." And I was like, you know, you can't get better than that. The war is not over, but I think the most part of it is done. When you look at our communities, we are sobering up. Our families are getting back together. We're in control of our communities and our lands. We're becoming a strong, proud people again. Now what we have to do is heal. As a grandfather, as a husband, that's my job now. Try to learn how to forgive. Have a little bit of peace in my life. Some humor. Look to Paul Andrew and all these people that know how to tell jokes. Not to take yourself so serious so you could sleep at night. And I don't want to die with a snarl or a frown on my face. And now it should be a little bit peaceful looking by then. So there's nothing magical about it. Somebody asked me about 20 years, is it, Steve, what do you think is your gift? I said, I think I'm a very ordinary person. Not too smart, not too dumb, just sort of in the middle there somewhere. What I have is the ability to see opportunities, to see a door open and act on it before it closes. That's all I had. And a wonderful company of exceptionally gifted leaders and workers who helped make everything happen. That was the magic of our time, and hopefully it'll continue into the future. Merci.
Merci. Thank you so much, Stephen. First, I want to thank all of our panelists. It's been an honor to hear your stories, in one case to interrupt you. And I appreciate your attention, your active listening. I can hear you listening in this room. You must be psychic, Richard Nersu, because I thought, how are we going to conclude this? And he slipped me a quote from H. Jackson Brown. You can get sympathy or you can get better, but you can't get both. You can be in your comfort zone or you can have growth, but you can't have both. You can be interested or you can be sold out committed, but you can't entertain both. You can have excuses or results, but you can't do both. Choose the path that develops your visceral fortitude, your strength. You can get sympathy or you can get better, but you can't have both. Choose the path that develops your visceral fortitude. I wish you all the best on your journey. I hope you heard some wisdom here. Renewal, family, roots, education, humor, music, and to round it all up, love, respect, and sharing. Thank you, Charlie. Thank you so much.